God, we give thanks to you for this day and the privilege to be able to gather together in this church with the community and other people who seek to follow your way. As we are gathered here, we pray that your Holy Spirit would be with us, giving us wisdom and insight as we open the scriptures and apply it to our lives. Help us to understand and to bring within our lives the word that you have for us. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, I was back several months ago feeling like I wanted to lead another Bible study and was kind of delving around different parts of the scripture and really felt like I wanted to do something on Paul's letters. And there are a wide variety of letters you could look at. There are 13 of his letters all together. And as you look at those, you can see how the church over the years has placed varying importance upon his letters. Romans is the first of those, mostly historians tell us, because it's the longest. If you read through the letters of Paul, they kind of go from the longest letters to the shorter letters. They also go from letters that were written to communities of faith to the personal letters, to Timothy and Titus, those being separated off. And then you have the other letters that were written. But before we get into that part, I selected Romans because it really is probably theologically the most hefty of his letters. I think really at the core, if you want to understand the Apostle Paul, you need to understand the letter to the church in Rome and Galatians. Those two are the ones that really carry the weight of his message and his understanding of the Christian faith. And so as we look into those letters, Romans felt like the appropriate place to put our time. Now to start, I want to step back from the scripture and talk a little bit about how we look at scripture, how we approach that in our own lives, and how we interpret scripture. And in John Wesley, founder of Methodism, we have kind of the seeds of an interpretive lens for us about how we form our faith. And in our tradition, we call that the Wesleyan quadrilateral. And I'm going to draw it as a diamond rather than a square, but that's the Wesleyan quadrilateral. Not all my letters look right, but my R's are not so hot, I guess. And what that says is we form our faith from four different elements. Any of y'all went through confirmation, you know this. The first of those is Scripture. And that's why I drew it as a diamond rather than as simply a square, because it really is primary. These are not meant to be four equal parts. They're people want to argue about whether they're equal or not equal. It's really not meant to be that kind of a formula. It's really meant to be just a good analogy for how we understand and put our faith together. And our primary place is from Scripture. That's where we have our encounter with who Jesus is, the stories that are handed down to us, where God speaks to us through the Word. And then, so we have Scripture, we have tradition, and that is how Scripture and faith has been interpreted to us and handed down. We're not the first ones who believed in Christ. There are other people who have long before us. Sometimes I think we may struggle with our faith, and we feel like we're the first ones to ever done it. If you go to our church library, it's full of books of people who, over the years, have wrestled with the issues of faith. And if we go there, we find those fellow companions along the way, you know, from St. Augustine. When you read, if you read his confessions, there's probably not a more modern book to be able to read about a person wrestling with their faith than St. Augustine's book called The Confessions. And it's just as real as could be. And if you read through it, he deals with all kinds of struggles in his life that are there. And you know, so we help look to folks like that. John Wesley has said, and this is partly inform our study on the book of Romans. He, one night, it was time for Bible study, and he didn't want to go. I mean, he just didn't want to go. He's like, good Lord, I've been to all the meetings. I started at 5 o'clock this morning in prayer. But he says he reluctantly went. And when he got there, the person who was leading it was reading from Martin Luther's preface to his commentary on the book of Romans. And he said, just in hearing the person read Martin Luther's reflection on it, he said, I felt my heart strangely warmed. And I knew that Christ died to take away my sins, even me. And all along before in his life, and I'm sure there were times he had understood that for at a personal level, but it came through in a way that he had not understood it before. And that was a part of the tradition informing his understanding of faith. Martin Luther, how Martin Luther had approached the book of Romans, helped rekindle his faith. So we have this whole tradition, 2,000 years of the church interpreting. And some people have gotten it wrong, some have gotten it right, and there's the whole discourse in between, and we get to partake in that and share in it. So that helps inform our faith. The third part is reason. God's given us the Bible. God's given us predecessors in the faith who's handed it down to us. And tradition, by the way, includes Miss Shirley Walker, who taught me in Sunday school. You know, I mean, that's the tradition because she learned about faith here at Epworth in Chickasha before she carried it on into Oklahoma City and taught at the church I grew up in. So, I mean, our tradition is this long part of it. But God gives us a brain. God gives us reason and expects us to use that. And so we allow reason to help inform our faith. It's not meant to just simply read it and believe it, but that we apply our knowledge and understanding to it. And so Scripture speaks to us, and reason at times may ask questions of it. Reason may inform it. It helps us to think through the whole of what we believe. But that's a part of what I believe God expects of us, is to be thinking Christians. And then the final part of this is experience. And by experience, the way that I think we interpret that is that God grants us experiences in our life and in our faith that help us help inform it, and that I think it covers a wide range of things, but it's primarily religious experience. In one place, this is very unusual for John Wesley because he said he is a man of one book, the Bible, but he in one place he was talking about a person coming to the place where they had faith, that kind of heartwarming faith he talked about. And he said, you know, I don't care how much Scripture a person knows as long as they know Christ in their heart. That it kind of experience is really important. Now, he wasn't saying the Bible's not important. What he was talking about is that there is this important part of our faith that is a part of our experience, our heartwarming experience, and that plays into this whole thing just as much as all the rest. And you know, I I don't need to break it down into one is 40%, another is 20%, or anything like that. They just work together. That's really the point of it. All these things work together to help us in our faith. So when we approach Scripture, it is at the top of this diamond, and it is the first of those. And it informs the others. The others can be in conversation with it, but it is the primary piece of it. And so when we approach looking at the Scripture, these others can be a part of the conversation, absolutely should be a part of the conversation, but Scripture has that special place there for us. The other thing is that I think, and this is the way I will approach the Scripture, and so this may be helpful, it doesn't have to be yours, but so that you know, this is kind of where I'm coming from. And I think there are three, I would call, interpretive worlds. And one is behind the text. Or historical. So we need to know the setting in which the Scripture comes to us. We need to know the time frame. We need to know the places, what that meant in its own time period and what it speaks to. All the time we'll run across phrases that have kind of been handed down to us, and we understand them differently than people did a couple hundred years ago when they may have originally been used. And it's important to understand what that original context was. Then the next is the within the text. And this is, literally just the literary world of the text. So when we're reading a scripture, is this come to us from the Old Testament? Does it come to us from the New Testament? Is it a song, like something that comes out of the book of Psalms? That has a different context, the literary way of speaking. I don't know if any of y'all have been watching the PBS Country Music series. I have, just fascinated with it. And, there's something about how a song speaks to us. And it's different than me getting up and just talking about this. And so that's a different way of communicating. Does it come from the prophetic materials? Does it come from the books of wisdom? Does it come from one of the Gospels? Or in this case, is it a letter that's written? Just think about this situation of it being a letter. Well, what do we know about a letter? Anybody get letters anymore? Have you gotten a letter in the mail? What's that?
You get email.
Email. Email's probably the closest we get that's personally written to us. But what do we know about that? Anybody ever had something you wrote in an email or online sent to somebody else where it's not taken in context? It can sound real different sometimes. A letter is really half of a conversation, isn't it? There was something that took place before. There's a relationship that's there. Maybe there was a letter that was written to begin with, and then the person writes a letter in response, and may not know the questions that were asked in the first letter. Maybe Ed writes me a letter. He said, "Scott, I was wondering about X, Y, and Z." And so when I write back to him, I may not put the question about X, Y, and Z, but I'll respond to those areas. And by reading it, you can kind of infer what maybe Ed was concerned about. and what his X, Y, and Z were by the responses that I give. So when we read a letter, and it's a very intimate thing usually too, the letters will address things at a more personal level. They're not really, Paul, when he wrote these letters, he wasn't thinking about anyone reading these 2,000 years from now. Paul thought Jesus was coming back in his lifetime. So he wasn't thinking about these hanging around for a long time. He was writing to address very specific circumstances at a very specific moment. And so understanding that that's part of what we're getting is kind of half of the conversation. The other day, Angie came walking into the house, and she had her phone talking. So as she was talking, I was listening to half of the conversation, right? Okay, as it went through, I could tell this was not about business, or it was not about the utilities, or it was not about any of those kinds of things. This was a personal conversation. This was either her sister Mary, our son Thomas, or our daughter Anna. So I lend the ear a little bit longer and closer. Well, no, it's not Mary because she said this. And then you begin to understand who it is she's talking to. And the letters are a lot that way. There's a whole literary piece to how letters are written, and we're going to spend some time talking about that. If it's in a letter, it sounds different to us than if it's in one of the Gospels where it's Jesus' words and his teaching. They tell us different things just simply by how they tell us. And then there's the in front of the text, and that is our contemporary world. And that's the concerns we bring to bear and how it speaks to our lives. And we probably have very different questions in some cases. At the heart of it, human beings are human beings. So the heart issues, the faith issues are still going to be the same. But we might ask a different set of questions as we approach it. And so that it speaks to our world in that way. So those are some of the things that I want us to kind of understand as we look at it. So sometimes we're going to look at Paul's letters, and we're going to try to understand the historical situation, to understand where Paul was in his missionary life, when this comes in the life of the church. Sometimes we're going to look at it and it's like, well, you know, so Paul's writing the letter, and so he opens with a greeting and salutation. How does that look? What does he include in that? From our own contemporary, all right, y'all should have corrected me. We'll kind of look at those pieces. So the first of these, what I want to do is kind of this part about behind the text, is to talk about how we get to Paul. And we're going to spend most of today kind of talking about these big overview things before we really delve into the book of Romans a whole lot. But the time frame, we know that, you know, just by calendar, Jesus is the time when our calendars begin, so year zero. And we know that Jesus' early life, until he was about 30, he was not in his active ministry, that Jesus has about a three-year period in which his ministry gets recorded for us in the Gospels. And so from 30 to 33, um, is the time of Jesus's ministry. We have, you know, early accounts of his early life. But mostly that's really along the lines of the birth stories. We have an account of when he was about 12 years old. We really don't have much that takes place in this, except when he begins his ministry after being baptized by John. We know that that's when he really begins this, his baptism by John, his headed out into the wilderness to kind of gain perspective on this, and then he comes back and begins to minister and to serve. And so he has this three-year period for his ministry. Then it's his early followers who tell the story of Jesus. So we have Jesus preaching. About the kingdom of God. Then we have his followers, the disciples, preaching about Jesus preaching. About the kingdom of God, right? And so we have that in oral form. This takes place in the churches where they gather. You know, the churches are cropping up. They're in Jerusalem. They're beginning to spread out in communities from around there, but primarily in the region where Jesus and his followers have been throughout their ministry. And then it begins to spread out. Little by little, going out to other places, and people beginning to pass this faith message along. And they're not thinking about writing it down. No one's writing it down in these early days because they believe Jesus is returning soon. And so that's not an important thing, because we've got Peter sitting here, and he can tell us the stories. You know, Peter, tell us about this, and tell us about that, and those folks are there to be able to pass it on. But what soon, you know, after a decade or two begins to happen is those people begin to pass on. And so there begins to be an importance about recording the message. And so we get later on the Gospels that are shared with us, and they're the collection of all those stories of Jesus's ministry, and those take place, are getting written down, but roughly 70 to 90 A.D. But there's this window in here, and so we have the Gospels that are written to us at that time. And if we were doing something about the Gospels, we could talk about Mark being the first, and then Luke and Matthew coming after that, and probably John after that. And if we do a class on that, we can spend a lot of time talking about kind of how that happened. But in this period in between, we have this ministry of the church teaching about Jesus and what Jesus taught. And in that period, we have Paul and Paul's ministry. And Paul's ministry, you can probably put down from 50 to roughly 65 AD in those first years. And so, you know, Paul is in ministry during that time period, and his letters come from this roughly 15-year period. Scholars will debate that. I can't tell you it's 65, It could have been 63, it could have been 67. You know, these are windows, really. But it's roughly during that time period that Paul begins his ministry outside of his Jewish tradition, that of being a Christian. Before that, we know he was a Pharisee among Pharisees, as he would say, and one who had devoted himself to the purity of Jewish faith, and in fact, even to the point where he helped persecute the church. All those things we know about him. And then he had this experience we talk about here. He had, in his day, scripture, which we would refer to as the Old Testament. He had a scripture background, but it was an experience on the road to Damascus of Jesus intervening in his life that really empowered and started his ministry. And that, we know, takes place sometime prior to that, year 50, but by soon after that, he's beginning to minister and serve in churches, and it takes a while for people to accept him. If you've ever had somebody who's been after you, it takes a while to feel comfortable enough to accept them before you begin to let them into your life. And so but that begins to happen. And in Paul's life, we have really a couple of places, scripturally, where we can learn about his life. And those are from his letters. And the book of Acts. So we're going to put this at roughly 90. The Acts of the Apostles, and which is, I think probably most of you will know this, but is chapter 2 of the 2-volume book of a book of Luke, and then the book of Acts, all written by the same author, to tell the story of who Jesus is and then how the early church took that message out. And an awful lot of the book of Acts tells us about Paul's life and ministry. We should probably look at these telling us the full story of Jesus or of Paul's life together. We'd look at Paul's letters as the primary part of that, and then Acts of the Apostles telling us a more reflective or a little more distant story of Paul's life. But obviously, if you can hear it firsthand, you're going to put that as the primary place to be able to learn that from. So we have Paul's letters that come to us during this historic time period. So, all right, we're about 30 minutes in, so that gives us about 15 minutes to start into this first part. And any of you have an English teacher who gave you a form for how a letter was to be written? Do you ever have instruction in that? Do you remember those lessons? Do you remember? How do you begin a letter?
Salutation.
With the salutation. Yeah, your greeting, your salutation. And Paul begins his letter that way. So let's take a look at it. Okay, so in Romans chapter 1, verse 1. So he says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which is promised beforehand through the prophets in the Holy Scriptures. The gospel concerning his son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness, by resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for the sake of his name, including yourselves, who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. Now, that's a pretty long introduction. Let's think about that. He's got a lot in there. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, and he's going to define himself by his relationship to who Jesus is. His relationship to Jesus is one of a servant. I serve him. He's my Lord. And that's where he begins this. But think about if you're writing a letter. If you're writing the letter or an email, as we talk about, to someone you know very well, do you need to introduce yourself when you write that letter? No, you don't. They know you. You don't have to put a lot of that in there. So that tells us something about his relationship to the church in Rome, doesn't it? He doesn't know them yet. He's not met them. They've not spent time in conversation. They've not spent hours sitting over the coffee table and visiting with each other. They've not spent time studying Scripture together in Sunday school class. They've not sat beside each other in worship for so many years that you know exactly where they're going to sit and when they're going to come in. They don't have that kind of history with each other. So he's wanting to give them his credentials, and he's given them the best he's got. It's probably one of the longer salutations of his letters, and I think it, in part because of that. He intends to visit them. He intends to come to them, but he's not been there yet. So they don't have a relationship to hearken back to. He can't say, it's so great to see you all last Christmas, or, whatever that, how that might look like if it were someone you were more intimate with. But he wants to put his credentials out there. So a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle. Now, in their day, an apostle was someone who knew Jesus. Not the way we spiritually know Jesus, but someone who lived with Jesus, was a friend of his teachings before his death and resurrection. Someone who was a part of that inner circle. And so the apostles are those 12 disciples and the early part of his followers that might have included 100 or more people that were close to him. And they were the folks who were considered as apostles. Now, we'll talk about this as we go forward, but Paul was not one of those who physically knew Jesus in that way. Later, he describes himself as an apostle untimely born, which means I know him, but I just didn't get to know him that way. For Paul, his encounter with Jesus on the Damascus Road is that sense of for him, apostleship, when Jesus speaks to him in that way. But he says that he is a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. Now, that's another part of what apostolic ministry is being set aside for a special role. And so when we talk about the priesthood of all believers, that we are all priests, followers of God, and I believe in my heart we all have a ministry that we are called to in our lives, and to minister to the people around us. I don't think that we hire the preacher to do that for all of us, but the leader of a community is called to serve in a special set-aside way, and that's what he's talking about here. set aside, set apart for the gospel of God, not as more special, but just a unique designation for that work. And so, again, he puts that as a part of who he is, which he has promised beforehand through his prophets and with the Holy Scriptures. So here he's grounding all of that in what the Scriptures have said about who Jesus is. And the gospel concerning his son, who was descended from David according to the flesh. This part's going to become important to us as we move through here. It isn't by accident that he talks about Jesus being descended from David, because one of the major themes in this letter is the relationship between those who are Jews and those who are Gentiles, and how the relationship that each of them share with Christ is important. And because in this early church, there's a lot of struggle between those who are Jewish Christians and those who are Gentile Christians, and about how Jewish do you have to be in order to be a Christian? In essence, how much of the Jewish law do you have to follow in order to be a Christian? And that gets debated out. They have a big council in the church, and they come to resolutions about certain things that they'll require a person to do, but other parts of the law they're not going to ask Gentiles to do. But this is one of the real tensions. Will Christianity be a branch of Judaism, or will Christianity be something distinct on its own? In the early days, it wasn't so simple. They didn't really know. If a person who was Jewish and Christian, they would go on Friday night, they would begin the Sabbath, and they would go on Saturday to worship in the synagogue. And then on Sunday, they would go to worship in the church, and because Sunday was the day of resurrection, was the day that Jesus was raised. But the Sabbath was the day of Jewish custom and practice. And they didn't see themselves leaving that behind. They saw Jesus as the fulfillment of it. Now, not everybody in the Jewish synagogue believed that. And so it began to be something of conflict in the probably almost as early as could be. But, they would say, Esten would come to time together for study, and he'd say, but Jesus is what this thing is all about. Whenever Isaiah says this, he's really talking about Jesus. And the folks who were Jewish but not Christian would say, Esten, we love you, but you just got to quit talking about Jesus all the time, because, he's not what this is about, and he's not what you think. And it got to the point much later, as we get into this period here, where it got so conflictual that eventually they asked the Christians to quit coming to the Jewish synagogue, and because they couldn't leave Jesus at the door. He was so central to their faith. They still saw themselves as Jewish in their practice and everything they did, how they were raised, the community they were a part of. But for them, it wasn't just adding Jesus on. It was that Jesus was all of it together. And to the point where it really wasn't going to work any longer. So that's the kind of the world in which Paul's living. Paul is very much a part of that. He was one of those, as he would tell you, who persecuted the church because they wouldn't conform to the practices of Judaism. They wouldn't quit talking about Jesus, and so he was a persecutor of the church. And in that way, it's a remarkable transformation that takes place in his life, that he moves from one who's on that side to being the person who is the most vocal proponent of the gospel going to people who aren't Jewish. He becomes the advocate. He is called an apostle to the Gentiles, he says. Let's look a little deeper here. So where it says, descended from David according to the flesh, That's where he's going to say, this is a part of this whole tradition of Judaism that we're a part of moving forward. And was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by resurrection from the dead. That his death was not the end. That it was vindicated through resurrection. Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for the sake of his name, including yourselves who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. So there he makes this real clear, so that there can be obedience of faith among all the Gentiles, that the grace we receive in Jesus is not just something to be owned by Jewish Christians, but it's for the whole world. And he's called to be the leader of helping enable that to happen. And so he's writing to the church in Rome to tell them, I'm wanting to come visit you, and I know these are struggles that you're wrestling with, and here's how I understand those views and those issues. And then the rest of the letter gets devoted to kind of responding to what he sees the importance and value of the Christian faith, about having faith in who Jesus is, rather than relying upon the practice of the law for our salvation, that we can have faith in Jesus for that. And then the last last verse of the salutation is to all God's beloved in Rome who are called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's to the church in Rome, the saints in Rome. And that's his designation for all those who seek to be followers of Jesus. They're among the saints. We think of saint as a person who, you know, I don't know, Saint Augustine, you know, who by the history of the church they've confirmed as a saint. But he's talking about all people, that when you're a follower of Jesus, you are a part of the saints. You are one of the saints. We are the saints. Some of us may be more close to holiness than others, but we're all working that journey out. And so we have that kind of called out special designation for who we are and in the church. So that's the beginning. I think we're right at our time. But that's kind of some of the ways that we're going to approach this. And we'll talk about, and I'll try to make real clear when we're talking about the historical or behind the text kind of issues that we're looking at. The ones within, about the literary structure and where this form follows within the Bible. And then the part that's more contemporary, the questions that we bring to bear as we approach the letter and how Paul is speaking to us today. This is probably the most controversial part of it. It's always going to be, because it's the things that we carry as a part of our interpretive lens. So that's kind of be our approach to this. So we'll wrap it up here. Any questions? Anything I said that you want me to clarify, or other expectations we might have as we go forward?